Declare that for you, now and forever, the day breaks and the shadows flee away. I welcome you this evening to this service to remember those in our lives who've gone before us, those who were important to us and who filled our life with joy and thanksgiving. In a few minutes, we will be lighting some candles and the pictures of your loved ones will flash on the screen. So again, I invite you to remember to take heaven where they now abide. Take peace, for they are at rest, and take joy for all that they continue to mean. I will light a candle for you to shatter all the darkness and bless the times we knew. Like a beacon in the night, the flame will burn bright and guide us on our way. Oh, today I light a candle for you. The seasons come and go, and I am weary from the change. I keep moving on. You know it's not the same. And when I'm walking all alone, do you hear me call your name? Do you hear me sing the songs we used to sing? You filled my life with wonder, touched me with surprise. Always saw that something special deep within your eyes. And through the good times and the bad, we carried on with pride. I hold on to the love and life we knew. I will light a candle for you to shatter the darkness and bless the times we knew. Like a beacon in the night, the flame will burn bright and guide us on our way. Oh, tonight, I light a candle for you.
Hallelujah. Ooh. stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till He appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Christ was born. Oh, night divine. Oh, night. Oh, night divine. Truly He taught us to love one another. His law is love, and His gospel is peace. Chains shall He break for His child. Let there be peace, peace to every nation. Let there be hope for all the world to see. Let there be love and joy to all the children. Let there be peace on earth for you. If I had one and let there be peace. Peace to every nation, let there be hope for all the world to see, and let there be love and joy to all the children. Let there be peace on earth for you and me. When I look in the mirror, all I wanna see is true compassion.
And those are the faces of people who were very important to you. Some young, some not so young, and every age in between. But for each and every one of you, I'm sure you would say that that person was taken far too soon. There was still another dream, another hope, or something else you hope to accomplish. Of all the holidays in the year, it is the holiday of Christmas that is the most emotionally laden. There is so much that we place into that one singular day, into that season, that causes us to be tripped up. For some, it is trying to recapture the feelings they had of a joy and wonderment when they were a child, but they forget that now that they've grown up, those childish wonderments are gone. For others, it's the sense of, I have to do it right. And so they get exceptionally busy with doing this, that, and the other thing, to somehow that if I just get it right, it will be good. But then the next morning, it doesn't feel that way. But for you, it is a sense that all of your traditions and all of the ways in which you celebrated this holiday have now changed, and not because you wanted that change, but because a death came into your life. At the very heart of the season that we call Christmas is the story of a child being born in rather unusual places, and the gift of light and hope coming into a darkened world. But if we peel away all the romantic pictures that we have of that event, we begin to see something that becomes rather familiar. In Luke's gospel, Mary and Joseph have to forego all the plans they had to have that child born at home in their beloved village of Nazareth. No, an edict from a distant government forced them to make a dangerous journey to Bethlehem. And when they arrived there to find that Joseph's ancestral home was filled with other people, they were forced to take lodging where the animals were stabled for the night. And it is in that unusual place, with all of their hopes and dreams dashed, that a child came into the world, a child that would bring some hope. In the only other story of that season that we have in Matthew's gospel, Mary and Joseph actually lived in Bethlehem. And after the child had been born, some very strange individuals from the east showed up, individuals who we know as the Magi. And they brought gifts to that newborn child. But because they didn't know exactly where to find the child, they made a tactical error. They journeyed to Jerusalem first and spoke to a despotic king. The king, when he found out he'd been tricked, then ordered the death of all children under the age of 2. And so Mary and Joseph, with all of their plans to live on in Bethlehem, those plans were now shattered, and they were forced to flee and take refuge. And for several years, they became refugees, living in the distant land of Egypt. And even when the angel finally told Joseph in a dream it was safe to go home, it was not home to Bethlehem, but home to a little town in the north country. It is into that season, this time of Christmas, that you now find yourself, longing and hoping for hope to return and a light to come. At the core of the season is that sense of light overcoming darkness and hope that things can be better. Here's a little poem called In December Darkness. The whole world waits in December darkness for a glimpse of the light of hope. Even those who snarl humbug and chase away the carolers have been seen looking toward the skies. The one who declared he never would forgive has forgiven. And those who left home have returned. And even wars are halted, if briefly, as the whole world looks skyward. In the December darkness, we peer from our windows, watching for an angel with rainbow wings to announce the hope of the world. It is in this season that you fear the tree, you fear the traditions, because somehow it won't be the same. But it's that tree and those traditions that are so very, very important. But what happens when hope gets dashed? What happens in the way that you think it should be when somehow you find out it isn't? Almost 130 years ago, a little girl by the name of Virginia O'Halloran had her hopes and dreams dashed. Her friends, whom she trusted very closely, had spoiled it for her. They told her there is no Santa Claus. She didn't know what to do. She asked her dad. And her dad said, you know what? If it's in the local newspaper, it has to be true. And so she wrote. And the editor of the newspaper responded with this. Virginia, your little friends are wrong. They have been affected by the skepticism of a skeptical age. They do not believe except what they see. They think that nothing can be which is not comprehensible by their little minds. All minds, Virginia, whether they be men's or children, are little. In this great universe of ours, man is a mere insect, an ant, in his intellect, as compared with the boundless world about him, as measured by the intelligence capable of grasping the whole of truth and knowledge. Yes, Virginia, there is a Santa Claus. He exists as certainly as love and generosity and devotion exists, and you know that they abound and give to your life its highest beauty and joy. Alas, how dreary would be the world if there were no Santa Claus. It would be as dreary as if there were no Virginias. There would be no childlike faith then, no poetry, no romance to make tolerable this existence. We should have no enjoyment except in sense and light. The eternal light with which childhood fills the world would be extinguished. You may tear apart the baby's rattle and see what makes the noise inside, but there is a veil covering the unseen world which not the strongest man, nor even the united strength of all the strongest men that ever lived could tear apart. Only faith, fancy, poetry, love, romance can push aside that curtain and view the picture, the unequaled beauty and glory beyond. Is it all real? Ah, Virginia, in all this world, there is nothing else real and abiding. No Santa Claus? Thank God he lives and he lives forever. 1,000 years from now, Virginia, nay, 10,000 years from now, he will continue to make glad the hearts of childhood. You see, grief seems to dash our hopes. When a loved one has parted and all of the busyness of that period of time has ceased and you're left with just yourself, grief is really love that has no object. So how do you move forward in a holiday season where you're searching for hope in the love? Those pictures are of that hope and that love. For all that they represented to you, and all of the strengths that they brought to you, and all of the ways in which you laughed. But the issue that we have with this season is so tied up in the way we do things, in the way we think it should be, and not at the core of the season. Remember, at the core of the season is a child that is being born into a world, a child that will challenge that world, a child that will bring hope and trust and a new way of living. But the season has so much to it. And sometimes we have to find in another way on what the season is about. I was saying to some of the staff members here tonight that there are two things that every year as Christmas draws about, I have to read and or see. One is I have to watch A Charlie Brown Christmas. There's just something about that lovely little cartoon of Peanuts and the gang that sets my heart in joy. But the other one is my perhaps most favorite story of all, The Grinch. Here's how it ends. It was 1:15 dawn, all the who's still abed, all the who's still a snooze when he packed up his sled. Packed it up with their presents, the ribbons, the wrappings, the tags and the tinsel, the trimmings and trappings. 3,000 feet up the side of Mount Crumpet, he rode with his load to the tip-top to dump it. Poo-poo to the who's, he was grinchously humming. They're finding out now that no Christmas is coming. They're just waking up. I know just what they'll do. Their mouths will hang open a minute or two. Then the who's down in Whoville will all cry, boo-hoo. That's a noise, grins the Grinch, that I simply must hear. So he paused, and the Grinch put his hand to his ear, and he did hear a sound rising over the snow. It started in low, then it started to grow. But the sound wasn't sad. Why, the sound sounded merry. It couldn't be so, but it was merry, very. He stared down at Whoville. The Grinch popped his eyes and he shook. What he saw was a shocking surprise. Every Who down in Whoville, the tall and the small, was singing without any presents at all. He hadn't stopped Christmas from coming. It came. Somehow or other, it came just the same. And the Grinch, with his Grinch feet, ice cold in the snow, stood puzzling and puzzling. How could it be so? It came without ribbons. It came without tags. It came without packages, boxes, or bags. And he puzzled 3 hours till his puzzler was sore. Then the Grinch thought of something he hadn't before. Maybe Christmas, he thought, doesn't come from a store. Maybe Christmas, perhaps, means a little bit more. And what happened then? Well, in Whoville, they say that the Grinch's small heart grew 3 sizes that day. And the minute his heart didn't feel quite so tight, he whizzed with his load through the bright morning light, and he brought back the toys and the food for the feast. And he himself, the Grinch, carved the roast beast. This season isn't about what was, but it's about what is. It isn't about the way we were, but the way we can be. It isn't so much about recreating the past, but instead looking toward the future, looking for a way in which to celebrate it that doesn't necessarily involve all the things of the past. Years ago, when I found myself in a difficult situation and my life was changing rather dramatically, and all of the trappings of Christmas weren't going to be at my hand, I thought, if I was the only person on this planet that was to celebrate this day, what would be the one thing I would want to do? And after a little while of thinking, I realized what I wanted more than anything was to be able to sit quietly on the morning of the 25th. No church service, no children, no meals to prepare, but simply to sit and reflect on where the hope and the light was coming into my life in that very dark time. And there I found what Christmas was about, the return of hope and joy, a return that something, somehow, some way that I can't imagine is a gift that is given to me at this time of year. This is a little poem that I'm also very fond of, Sitting on the Hillsides. Most of us who gather in Bethlehem on this night are not the star seekers. We've not traveled our dreams month after month and year after year, poring over predictions and promises. Most of us sit on our hillsides, tending our sheep, business as usual. Oh, we've heard rumors of stars, but we don't really give ourselves to seeking. After all, there's more than enough to do in the daily tending. We're simply not on the lookout for stars, nor expecting any light in our darkness. I suppose the important thing is, in the light of the glory of the Lord, to recognize the voice of an angel and to get up and, in spite of our sheep, go even unto Bethlehem to see this thing that has happened. In this year, celebrate the life of the one that you loved. Do something to honor that life. A picture on a tree, a portrait at the table, a meal that was their favorite. But to celebrate it in a sense that all that they are is still very much yours. That the light they imparted to your life is a light that will stay with you forever. Just as the lights of those candles burning before you beneath the pictures of the people above is a symbol of light and hope coming into the world. That's what this Christmas is about. Life, light, and hope. May you have a blessed season. May you celebrate those who are important to you. And may the hope of the season carry you through. As we conclude, you're invited to retire to the aviation lounge of the funeral home and there to take a few moments to partake in a drink and a sweet and to share some stories about the person who was important to you.
Saved.